Let's start the meeting today. Welcome to the meeting of the Hopkinton Planning Board. It's Monday, the 21st of December, 2015. I'd like to thank HCAM for recording the meeting tonight. The agenda, we actually have three continued public hearings, of which we might actually have some closure on several of them today, hopefully. We're going to be talking about master plan special permit for Legacy Farms, site plan review for the Hopkinton Tennis Club, site plan review for 3440 Hayden Rowe, and also the scenic road hearing primarily on Wilson Street today. Happy holidays to everyone. Hopefully, everyone is getting into the mood and the spirit, and we won't dull that mood and spirit too much tonight. We'll have a good end of the year here. As it is Hopkinton Planning Board's tradition, we take usually the meeting before the Christmas holidays to thank Elaine and Kobe for all the work that they do for us every year. And on behalf of the members of the Planning Board, we have two small gifts. And they're small because, not because that's what we think you guys do for us, but that's the maximum amount that the Massachusetts Ethics Commission will allow us to bribe you with.
Does he want to be ethical?
And with a couple lawyers being on the board and past lawyers, they pointed out that we can't be too generous, or we're going to all go in the slammer, so. Anyway, so we've got a kind of a busy meeting tonight. Let's start off with, Roy had asked that the East Main Street road work, come on up, go first so that we can get that through. I don't know whether people have been by the East Main Street Legacy Farms roadway, but it's pretty well set except for, I believe, seed.
It actually seeded, it just hasn't germinated, and it won't till spring.
Okay. So basically, we hold, I believe, a half a million dollar bond on that particular area. And since the work is done, FS&amp;T, I think is the consultant?
Weston and Sampson.
Oh, Weston and Sampson, okay. And they recommend that we release the bond?
The work is done.
The work is done. So entertain a motion to release the bond for that intersection.
So moved.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion?
I have one question.
Go ahead.
Are there trees in addition to the loam that's going to go up and around that area?
Oh, there's going to be quite a few trees, but that's something we'll do in the spring.
Okay.
It's not part of the road project, it isn't. It is part of the beautification project.
I think that was kind of, yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Any other questions? Okay, seeing none, are you ready for the vote? All those in favor of releasing the bond, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed, anyone abstained, motion carries. While we've kind of got Roy here in a captive seat for a second, how are we doing on finishing up Legacy Farms Road South?
Legacy actually did a little bit of repair work there this past week in a couple of low spots. We'd actually like to finish paving it, but we've been sort of timing that with Pulte's work on the south side. Last thing we want to do is pave it and have all these trucks driving on it. We're hoping sometime this spring they will have the majority of anything on the road directly itself done or adjacent to it. At that point, they're moving down the street on Clinton Street. They've got a little 45-unit subdivision going in back there, and they'll be doing some houses directly on Clinton Street. So I would hope for sure in 2016, we finish the road, and then probably go to town, I guess we've got a town meeting when, in May?
Well, you'd have to have it done well in advance of May. I don't know that you can make it.
No, no, I'm not saying this coming May.
Oh, you're talking.
I'm saying if we do it in 2016, unless you have a fall town meeting, we'd have to wait to the next May, correct?
Yep.
So if there's any chance you have a fall town meeting, we'd like to get it done and approved before that.
Okay, because I know you've mentioned you wanted to entertain a couple of changes to the intersection.
Yes, we're going to come back to you with some thoughts on those plans. Also, we'd like to, in January, transfer the land for the playing fields to the town. We're in the process of moving the loam down there as we speak. That'll probably be done the next 2 weeks, and we have to secure it for the winter and then transfer it ideally in January.
Okay. Other questions for Roy on other subjects before we open up the public hearing on the special permit?
Would that, I have one question, Mr. Chairman.
Yeah.
Would that land be going to Parks and Rec? Is that who would take control of that?
It goes to the town of Hopkinton. It's purely up to you who, I'm not quite sure.
I'm not sure how the condition, I think Parks and Rec might have been put into, into the...
I'd have to look at
the town of Hopkinton.
Yeah.
Then.
Yeah. But I thought it was town of Hopkinton, Parks and Rec.
I'd have to look.
The deed doesn't, I don't think,
says that. The deed won't.
No, the deed won't.
The Board of Selectmen
won't. Sure. As you know, the town has already voted at town meeting to accept it, so it's just a function of transferring it.
Yeah. Okay. So let's see. Let's open the continued public hearing. This is the application to amend the Legacy Farms master plan special permit. This is to increase the number of dwelling units by 180 age-restricted units. This is primarily affecting the north side at this point. Let's see. Last time, I think we all had a pretty well confusing bunch of language that maybe has gotten better, but I don't know. We'll see. See where the board members feel on that.
I think it's gotten significantly better, Mr. Chairman, because we left the lawyers out of it and worked with Elaine directly.
Okay. So let's go through those conditions and the changes just so everyone understands where we're at and make sure that we've done what we need to do. Elaine, do you want to take it through it, so given you started this?
So in condition number two, it's just a matter of changing the numbers to reflect what town meeting voted. So increasing the number of dwelling units to 1,120 and reducing the number of single-family homes to 15, which is what's on the south side. So there'll be no more single-family homes on the north side. And then in condition number three, this is a condition which talked about the amount of square footage of various things that were going to be constructed. So it's modified to reflect either the construction of Legacy Park commercial as originally proposed or the 180 age-restricted dwelling units in the Legacy Park area, which is right up on Wilson Street. So that's the only change there. So it's the one or the other, as opposed to the previous one, which just was the commercial. So now it's the choice.
So basically, at this point, we don't force them to make a choice?
Not until it's ready to be developed.
Okay. Let's go through them all and maybe come back to that one.
And then in number four, this is the condition that was really talking about the mixed-use nature of the project, which is changing if the 250,000 square feet of commercial is not constructed. So it downsizes basically the minimum amount of commercial activity that has to be both north and south to reflect what is more indicative of where the project is going. So instead of talking about office use and non-retail on the south, it talks about just commercial uses, which is defined in the bylaw. So it just refers to commercial uses and then reduces or changes the number of multifamily dwellings to what is actually potentially the minimum to be built because it's already built.
I'm confused because on the single family, it says not fewer than 15 single family. That's not, they're talking about the south parcel, whereas back under condition two, no more than 15 single family. And I thought all along we were capping the number of single family homes throughout at about 15.
And 15 is what's on the plan currently. So in either event, it's 15.
Well, why does it say not fewer than? That sounds like that's the minimum.
If I could comment on that. I think the reason being, Claire, was originally the plan was to have a certain percentage on the south side and the majority on the north side.
Mm-hmm.
So the reason it says no fewer than, because they didn't want us to do 10. They didn't want us to do 12. They want to do 15 at minimum. So there was split between the north and the south. The language is geared more towards what it was originally.
So they wanted 15 on the south, period.
No fewer than.
So it's unchanged from today, and that's what's
yeah.
being built.
It makes it sound like the target is for, you know, 15 or more. Why not just say 15? I mean, are we saying we want to open the door for more, or are we saying that it should be 15, no less, no more, 15?
Well, actually, the way it's been permitted, you can't do more than 15, because the south side is fully permitted, so you couldn't do more than 15 at this point.
If I could pick up Claire's point.
Why not say 15?
I agree with what you're saying, and I hear what you're saying about the entirety of the agreement. But if we're wordsmithing it now for clarity, why can't we? I say I agree with what Claire's saying. It's a change to 15 as opposed to not more or at least.
You can do that. The result is the same.
You could just say no more than.
Or just the number.
Either way.
Well, yeah, are we saying we definitely want to get 15? In which case, let's just say 15.
There are 15.
You're getting 15.
Okay, then let's just, this is just...
That's fine.
To me, it's confusing.
Say if we just leave it a number and it's clear that's the number, and if there's any problem, say there's an Indian graveyard or a giant meteor lands there, and you can't build one of the houses, you're not... It's not a problem with the documents so much as to have them be above or below. We can just work around it.
Why don't we just take out no fewer and just put in shall, at full build-out, shall be 15.
You have to put not more than, because later in the sentence it talks about and not less than, so grammatically you should
okay.
change it to not more than 15.
Okay, but the bit about the 60,000 square feet, that is not less than because we still want to leave the door open that there could be more.
That's right. So already there, it exceeds 60,000 square feet.
Okay.
All right. because the retirement counts as commercial.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Okay.
So we have at least 60, so we meet that. The
suppose it doesn't matter.
Does that change to need a motion?
Not yet, because we'll vote on the whole thing if we get to the point. Going back to the...
Quick question, though. So I guess I just want to continue on then. Is it full build-out not fewer than 290 multi-family dwellings? I mean, it's the same wording.
It's on the north side. So the first sentence is south, and the second sentence
is north. Okay.
But then it doesn't. But then the second sentence doesn't. Where this gets too confusing for me, if I go back to condition two, where we say that you can do 1120, and then you have condition three. That says he still has an option. Well, you can't do 1120 if you take the option of the other part.
So it's a maximum.
I believe it's a standard. If you go over to the 941st unit, in other words, if you go over by one, mm-hmm. it trips. You eliminate the commercial.
And condition number two is the mm-hmm. maximum number of dwelling units. And elsewhere, it says that in no case should any of this apply if they elect to stop building and build less.
I don't know. I'm still confused on the wording.
If I could just read it. If a building permit for the 941st unit, new dwelling unit, has been issued, such commercial uses in either case shall be allocated among the subdivision, blah, 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 blah. So I think my interpretation of this is if you build one unit beyond the 940, you negate your commercial capabilities on that parcel.
Right.
Do I have that right?
Then you're in the 250 range.
But what if you go the other way? You build the commercial first, and then you come up with the residential.
Well, I don't think... I think
you can't do both, because
you can't
it's the
do
same
both.
Land.
Do we want to, do we want to come to a situation where we eliminate the commercial?
Yes.
That's what this does.
Because you're taking the land that was going to be devoted to commercial. It's one piece. So you're taking that legacy park, and it's mentioned in the next to last sentence, and that either goes one or the other.
My understanding is if you do 1 square foot of commercial on that parcel, you negate the residential. If you build 1 unit of residential, you negate the commercial.
Okay.
I didn't see it that way, but...
When it's referring to...
I'm having a hard time reading it like a lawyer would. That's the problem that I'm having.
So at the end of number 3, when it talks about Legacy Park, that's the area that we're talking about for the 941st or the commercial.
And so there's no middle ground. It's either or. You either do the 180
commercial
and the 250 square commercial, or you do no senior housing and all commercial. There's no, like, I won't do 180, I'll do 90. Or if you do 90, you're automatically kicked back into that 250,000.
See, the problem I have with condition 2 is if he builds the commercial, then he should be able to build all 35 additional single-family houses.
But that's not what...
No,
that's not what we agreed to.
...town meeting, and it was presented to the public in the public hearings and at town meeting. Part of the problem is that it has to remain revenue neutral and revenue positive, so it's a fiscal...
Yeah, the single-family houses would disturb that.
...as opposed to another kind of consideration. So to make it more fiscally positive.
Well, then basically, I think you're asking them to make the choice. Now, it's either you do the commercial or you do the senior housing, and we write it. If you're ready to proceed with the senior housing, then we change it to that. I don't like this either-or type of item.
Well, the concern, Ken, is for whatever reason, let's say for whatever reason, the board didn't approve the site plan review for the residential, just whatever reason. Mm-hmm. You want to have the fallback mm-hmm. for the commercial. I mean, we did this before with Legacy when we first did the overlay, when we said the overlay didn't take effect until such time as we actually pulled our first permit or filed for our first review, mm-hmm. and then that kicked into place. And the idea here is, let me be perfectly clear, we want to do the 180, not the commercial. But for whatever reason, if we didn't have the rights to do the commercial, excuse me, the residential, we still want the right to do the commercial.
Okay.
And, you know, my assumption was we'd come in with a site plan review. The site plan review hopefully would be approved. And the minute we pull our first building permit, you can no longer do commercial.
Mm-hmm. And the zoning changes adopted at town meeting allowed for both circumstances.
Yep.
I mean, is the question around the theory of what he talked about there, or is the question around the language is how it's written?
I guess it's more the language. But I honestly think at this point you ought to make a decision one way or the other, as opposed to keeping up options. I mean, we should change nothing until the other option is going forward. I mean, we're kind of spending wasting time with this whole thing.
Mr. Chairman, I just have a question.
Sure.
You know, maybe shame on me. Legacy Park, in quotes, is that the entire north parcel? Or?
No.
So do we have a board that shows where
yes.
the Legacy Park...
It's just the senior housing.
It says it's labeled as Legacy Park.
It's in the upper northern.
That's where the commercial was going to be.
Yeah.
Wilson Street.
Well, one portion of the commercial.
Right.
It's just the 180.
Do you know where Wilson and Rafferty are?
Yes.
Just north of Rafferty.
Yep. Okay. It is now, okay.
So the master plan that the board approved along with the special permit had that labeled Legacy Park.
Okay. I don't think I remember seeing it labeled Legacy Park.
How do 180 units fit in on this parcel?
Well, they do. We, you know, at some point we'll get you a plan.
There was a plan that showed at town meeting.
That was very schematic. We're working on a more detailed version of that. This is not approving a site plan. This is purely sort of adopting the language of the town meeting. So, in fact, we're sort of in simpatico with that.
Well, I mean, the board doesn't have to approve a master plan special permit. And I guess I'm just looking to understand more what we're getting at the end of the day. But that's just me, maybe. I don't know.
Well, I think the intent was to align the special permit with the changes that were voted in May. Right now, there's a mismatch between the special permit that covers the entire development and what the zoning allows.
Okay.
So zoning allows something different than master plan special permit.
Sure, but zoning always allows something different than what a master plan special permit does. I mean, we don't have to go to the maximum amount of zoning in this board either, do we?
No.
Okay.
But if the board wants to decide now that it's not going to permit the 180, then I think the developer should know that.
Well, I guess if that's the question, then we want to look at what we're going to get with it in a little more detail than just making the language.
But that's not the purpose of this. That's site plan review. This is really just trying to mirror the language.
The site plan review is if it meets the criteria of site plan review, we approve it. A special permit allows us to take more things into consideration if we want.
So is there a concern about the 180?
I don't know how they're going to fit. For one.
Again, my understanding was that this was just, this document, at least this stage, was to incorporate the language and the changes that were made at town meeting into this document. For instance, as an example, eliminating the 50 single-family homes down to 15, changing the units potentially from 940 to 1120, and picking up, these are actually, relatively speaking, fairly small changes, and at that stage make a decision once we know going forward what's going to be there and how.
I can give some feedback. Mm-hmm. I agree with Ken a lot on this. And I hear what you're saying, Roy. I think, though, that in my view at town meeting, what happened is that the zoning was change for food. There's a new idea for this property, and we're looking at the master plan. It doesn't mean right now that we're taking anything away by having this in front of us. I would like to see a document in front of us that doesn't take anything away but adds to, because
this is not taking anything away
from your options and from the town's options, and I don't see that. I don't hear it, actually, although I don't see that understanding. I would like to see, I hear your idea of aligning the master plan with the zoning change, the zoning addition. But I agree with Ken, it's for us, it's not just that simple. There's more details. And
what details, continue, but I want to ask, what details are you looking for?
Well, up till before town meeting, we had general master plan laid out. This is in general. This is where a commercial property would be. At town meeting, the zoning was approved by one vote, but every vote counts, which is important. And now that change allows for the 180 senior housing units. But the reality of it is, there may be some issues and. Who knows? Maybe you can only physically get 176 in.
Well, but that's a different issue. That's this here is a master plan special permit based on zoning. That's an issue relative to site plan review and whether it fits or not.
But the rest of my point, and yeah, it's all future stuff. But say, well, if 176, we can't really make it work. So maybe we do. We don't have to restrict ourselves. Maybe we do half of commercial space, half senior housing. Maybe that commercial space is some sort of medical situation. So I wouldn't want to restrict that possibility because you already have that, I think, now.
And the way this is written, I don't actually see the whole thing like that.
So right now, there's no ability, I mean, under the previous zoning, there's no ability to construct residential at Legacy Park.
Right.
Wasn't allowed. So the zoning was changed in May to allow residential there, but it didn't take the commercial away either.
Right.
But it's either or. It's not both. Yes, because that was their choice, and that's what they offered to the town.
Yeah. If I understand this correctly, what we passed at town meeting provided an either-or. It wasn't set in stone. It provided an either-or option. And what we've got now is enabling language that is not enabling. It's pre-town meeting. And so, to a certain extent, this is a housekeeping thing to make sure we get language in place that matches what was proposed, what was passed at town meeting, which provides an either-or
correct
facilitation to match the either-or bylaw that got, or change that got passed at town meeting. Clearly, in this entire legacy process, which was understood to be a, you know, anything between 10, 15, even 20 years, it was understood that both the proponent and the board would have room to make alterations based on changing conditions because nobody has a crystal ball to see 20 years out what the situation is going to be. And even now, where, you know, you've got Hopkinton Retirement Village, you've got that senior housing thing in Ashen, that, you know, there are things coming in the pipeline right now that, you know, by the time they're ready to build, it still might not be as advantageous as was once thought. So those, that flexibility needs to be built in there. But it looks to me, the way this is written, as if the trigger mechanism is there, that once you step over the line into over 940, you've got a fish or cut bait. Then you need to, it's decision time. So there is a requirement for, at some point, to make a decision. But it leaves Mr. McDowell with the ability to still assess the market and decide when he's ready what is in the town's best interest as well. If the market changes, it's not in the town's best interest to do something that's not.
So why would we want to restrict that? I mean, I kind of in his camp on this, right, that the language, I think, kind of aligns with what was done at town meeting, but gives that option
right
to do
right
that.
The other part that I'm just bringing it up, but it doesn't sound like we're going to be ready for a vote tonight because we're already beyond time, but I don't see where this talks about the additional units anywhere in this master plan special permit being senior housing and all the stuff that goes with senior housing. It just gives them additional dwelling units.
Because the zoning specifies that, so it doesn't have to be repeated.
Yeah. Okay. Mm.
Right. Yeah. Actually, in the first section,
if you want to put senior housing, that's fine.
I think we're already 5 minutes over where we really wanted to be tonight, and I don't want to. We've got three other folks who want to get through. I'd entertain a motion to continue this to February 8th at 7:30.
So we'll
second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion.
Yes, Mr. Chairman. Is there anything here that we can kind of knock off, or does it need all be done on?
Well, it's got to be done at once.
Okay. Facilitate the process.
Yep. All those in favor of the motion to continue the public hearing, say aye.
Aye.
Anyone oppose?
No.
Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Okay.
Clarify, were you just saying about the feedback about the senior housing? So in our description in section one, it says senior housing, okay, but in the condition itself, it doesn't. So that, for clarity, maybe it's something like that.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, we'll try to sort those up. Mr. Nation, you want to come up here real quick because I see you're waiting. You've got two things here. Penny Meadow Lane, of the bond, I believe, or no, to set the bond. In about 2 minutes. Let's see, Penny Meadow Lane. I think you're looking for a bond recommendation of $39,045.
Before you this evening was FST's reviews that
month. Oh, okay. Oh, so it's somewhere else. So they're looking at $71,000.
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah, I wanted to take the opportunity to look at that. I have issue with a couple of them.
Okay.
So I think now's the time to bring
sure.
it up.
Yep.
So I'm not, I believe you've, some of us have probably been down there, seen that the road's got binder, much of the swale is done. Basically everywhere that we abut other people's property, the road's done, seeded, kind of nothing's germinated. But the work remains in front of the four house lots, but everything else is better than it's ever been. So going through the numbers here from FS&T and the drainage portion, I have issue with some of these. I don't think that they're accurate in the sense that we're not going to even, they're just not going to happen, as in going down the drainage section on a flared end. There's one listed at 950. I don't believe that's an accurate number for a flared end. We're doing HDPE pipe there, and those flared ends, they're, you know, $60-$80 a piece, and we have to install them. But put that on the shelf for a minute. There's no head walls that are going to happen down there, and we have eight listed at 700 a piece. That's $5,600. So, you know, you've got to look at the plan, but there is no head walls. It'll be much like the Hunter's Ridge job we've done, where we have the water quality swales on the side of the road, and everywhere there's a pipe, we have a flared end. So the eight head walls are really flared ends, but I don't want to use the 950 number for those because I don't believe that's accurate. So those two kind of tie together. And the other number that just I don't think should be in here is the 4,000 for the leaching pits, and that's relative to the house lots. So those are part of the conservation, you know, order of conditions, and there for each home would have the leach pit, and that's not going to have anything to do with the road itself. Meaning, if the town had to finish the road, they're not going to have anything to do with leach pits on the four lots. So if you're still following that, that makes me remove the 5,600, the head walls. It makes me remove the 4,000 for the four leach pits. But then it makes me take the flared ends and make it would be, it's nine total flared ends, but I'd call them $100 a piece. So it has me making the 950 on the drainage section be 900 with a quantity of nine. And I remove the 5,600 for the head walls, and I remove the 4,000 for the leach pits. I'm not sure if I
Lane,
explained
yeah,
that.
Yeah, I understand what you're talking about. Lane, on the, I understand, the leach pits to me is a no-brainer. That one's fairly easy to do. But the head walls, I don't know.
Yeah, this came in this evening, to this block or so I haven't had a chance to talk about it with Dave.
Well, let's put it this way. I'm building a road, and I don't have any intention of building any head walls anywhere.
Got it.
And I'm just looking at it, and, you know, I have a plan here, and I'm building it per the plan, as I understand the plan. And instead of a head wall, I have a flared end.
Got it.
And that's so that grading is appropriate.
Sure, right. Unfortunately, where we are is we usually kind of trust the engineer to get on the same page, and I'd be willing to easily drop the 4,400, actually 48, with the contingency out of that number. Because that's something that I think we can understand. The rest of it, I think you go fight them out with the consulting engineer or the inspector, and come back, and the next one we'll take it out if you can convince them.
Right. Well, ultimately, I would build it. It'll have the flared ends,
sure.
And then he'll see the flared ends and not the
$100, put them in, and he'll call it complete.
Yeah. I mean, so that would have us just removing the 4,000 for the leach basins at this
point? 4,800, because you get the contingency off of it, too.
Gotcha.
I mean, I can easily take that. I don't know, board members, that. So whatever that number is, 71, right. 6 minus 4,800. Mm-hmm. Entertain a motion for that amount to be set as the bond cost.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion?
Discussion. I know the numbers match up from our documents and then documents from 20th Century Homes. I'm a little bit confused because some of the items that we're talking about aren't in the list. I'm assuming the parts of the list, like the finished course of pavement for roadway. So the number we're talking about, 4,100, is part of that subsection?
I'm not sure what Frank's looking at.
What are you looking at? Are you looking at
the document from 20th Century Homes on the back has all this.
Is that the right subdivision, Frank?
Yep.
Yes.
Yep. Okay.
The number one is what's in the...
So it's in a different order in FST's list.
And FST's talks about 18,000 for tough course.
Yes. Using a different quantity.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I'm a little confused about what the differences between the documents.
Yeah.
But if the number we're talking about is how much? 4,100 different? Not different, but 4,100 for the parts that Mr. Nation doesn't think should be included. That makes sense, that part, but the middle part's what I'm missing. I see the beginning, I see the end, but I don't see the parts in the middle.
I guess I don't understand the question.
Yeah.
So they had, for paving, they originally had an amount in there. So in a different amount, different quantity, and a different unit price. And Dave is using a different quantity and a different unit price. He's saying that, so what the town's engineer does is he comes up with the town's cost to complete it. And frequently it's a bit different. So if the town had to step in and finish, that's what we'd be looking at, is what Dave is saying.
What would cost us versus what it costs.
I think it
costs the town more.
In the interest of the hour, I think these different engineers need to get together and get some kind of something that we can act on that's more consistent.
I agree with Cliff.
There's a motion. Go ahead.
I'm good with, if we're going to remove the leach pits, that makes me happy.
62.
And we go with that number, and we'll come back as soon as we're able after we've completed some more stuff and try to.
Sure.
We'll
reduce it as you get build it.
Okay.
So I think is it 66,820?
I think it's 66,862 is what I got with the math.
Okay. You're probably adding it. You're looking at better. Oh, I had it wrong. Okay, go ahead. So the number is what?
66,862.
Right. So that's what the motion is to set the bond at. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Okay, we're also looking for a quick lot release, I believe.
Yes, to release three of the lots.
Release three lots.
When the bond is received.
Yes. So entertain a motion to release three lots when the bond is received.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Okay. That's got Penny Mill Lane, I think, done, right?
Yes.
Okay, then we're at Conley Hills Estate, and there's a reduction. This is to reduce it to 12,000, I believe, per the engineers, inspecting engineer.
Yes.
So I entertain a motion to reduce the bond amount in Conley Hills Estate to $12,000.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded, seeing no discussion. How do you vote?
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries.
Thank you. Next.
Thanks. Look. I'm glad you got Penny Meadow Lane done before winter.
Yeah, we have it on our side.
Yes. Good. Yeah, it looked pretty good too.
Keep on going.
Yep.
Thank you.
Sure. Okay, now we're running a little late, but we'll try to make it up here somehow. We're at opening the continued public hearing for site plan review, special permit application for the Hopkinton Tennis Club. Come on down. Before we get going, I'd like to entertain for the record, we did receive a letter from the Sportsman's Club, from the attorney from the Sportsman's Club, similar to the one we received on other parts of the property, and we want to note that for the record, and I believe we already talked about potentially having a similar condition that we had from, on the other part of the parcel for that. So, let's see, where were we?
All right.
It seems like it's been a while, but I guess it hasn't been that long.
Time does fly. For the record, John Cusick with Bowler Engineering. We've been before the board a few times, and most recently, when we were last before the board, some of the outstanding items that we wanted to get back in front of DRB for their review of essentially lighting, landscaping, and signage. We had a very very fruitful meeting with them last week. I believe you have something in your correspondence. But the bottom line is they approved the or recommended approval of the landscaping as submitted. They didn't have any modifications to that. We presented the signage to them. I think they were comfortable with the signage that was part of the proposal. And then lighting, as you know, we've had a lot of back and forth and a lot of options relative to lighting. The plan we presented to the DRB, they viewed upon favorably. I will make just a quick explanation of what we did when we spoke last time. So we had a bunch of different plans. We had some that were 22-foot poles. We had some that were 18s. We had some that were 15s and iterations in between. The last plan that was submitted and reviewed by the DRB was essentially an iteration which we used 18-foot poles, and we changed the bulb from a standard metal halide to an LED fixture. The changing to an LED fixture helped to keep the lighting levels lower. As many of you may or may not know, when you use an LED light, essentially you can use a little bit of a lower foot candle and still get a consistent lighting level. The DRB, when we met with them, they were less concerned with having a slight deviation in the height of the light, as opposed to making sure that the light levels presented were of a level that was low and really as low as we could do. So the plan that was submitted has 14 18-foot LED lights. Just to read the highlights to you, because that's really I think what you'd be interested in. The maximum light level on the property, within the parking lot, excuse me. So that's within the parking lot. Maximum is 2.3.
Can I just walk up what he's doing so I can see?
Sure, come on in.
So the max.
Yeah, if you're
sure.
The maximum within the parking lot is 2.3 foot candles. The minimum is 0.3, and your uniformity ratio was a 3-to-1. So those levels are within the criteria that you establish, and actually well below what you establish. And I think they're actually lower than the plans that that were presented to us from the abutting property. They had some light levels up in the 7s and the 8s, actually. So we're able to get those light levels down to levels less than and consistent with what was asked of us. We are 3 feet higher than the 15 feet that is in the requirements. The reason that we're at 18 as opposed to 15, as I think I presented, I think it was the last hearing, we have a very, very large septic system that's right in the middle of our parking lot. We can't put lights in the middle of that just because of the septic system there. So they have to be a little bit higher so we can get that spread on the light to cover those areas. again, I think I presented this last time too, but it is notable that the site does dip down into the site a little bit. So we're not going up into the site, we're actually coming down into the site. So that 3 foot increase over what is in the ordinance is actually mitigated by the drop into the site. Consistent with the other plans that we had presented, we also make sure they're really, you know, we have full cutoff lights. It doesn't, there's no upshining. It's all downward facing. And there's no spillage onto abutting properties, which will be important for you.
Yes.
So with that, I could answer any questions on the lighting plan, you know, but I know we had a lot of discussion.
Can we see the notes? We can blow it up.
Yeah, that's cool. Listen, the main reason that I'm here, just guys, so everybody knows, is...
Name and address, please.
Oh, my name is Saul Oven, and I'm at 20 Lumber Street. I have those 3 lots. And what was promised to me when McIntyre, when Hopkinton Auto went up, none of those lights would shine on my house or on the street. And I complained 50 times. Don't worry, don't worry, don't worry. And the lights, to this day, shine there. And the only reason they don't shine there anymore is Tommy McIntyre built his building there, so I don't see the lights anymore. I do not want to be lied to. I do not want the same thing to happen again. And that's what happened when that property went up. I don't mind anybody building. I'm not in the way of progress or anything. But I don't want those lights that I have to start pulling down my blinds at night. If the lights are on, I would like to know what time they go off.
All right. Well, let's answer that question for you first. We're really talking about site lighting at this point. Let's try to focus it on that. Mm-hmm. I believe we had earlier talked about a plan where they're off within an hour of the business closing. If my memory is, you know, hopefully my memory is okay with that. And so that kind of answers that question. So, and I don't know what the hours of a tennis club are.
Generally, 11 would be late.
Okay.
But it could conceivably be that.
Okay.
To me, that's pretty late.
Yeah.
To me, that's very late.
So we're talking about lights on till midnight?
Within an hour is midnight.
And the one thing, just to talk to that, just for your benefit so you can see. So this is the road over here.
Yeah.
Those, zoom up on this. These are the light readings, those numbers, and those are the foot candles. It's how you measure light. When you come down, if you see the road where you're at on this side,
yeah,
it's all zeros. So the town has requirements that they require lights to be, number one, they require them to be like within the casing so it doesn't shine up,
yeah,
shine straight down. The other requirements that they have, and it's not so much us being good guys, it's the requirement that it is. You can't shine light onto other properties, so you have to design it that way.
Yeah.
So the lights you're referring to may have been done before the ordinance.
Yeah, this was a while ago.
Yeah.
So but I just know that what I was promised and what changed, and no one cared about anything that I had to say. And it wasn't this board or anything like that. It was just, that's how it was. Shut up, kid. Do what you got to do. This is what's going up.
Well, I think we're a little more sensitive to the lights these days. That's not to say that there might be a glow, but there won't be anything shining in your windows,
correct?
Yeah.
I mean,
okay.
You know, I mean, yeah.
Well, I'm just saying.
I can see my neighbor's driveway down, you know, half a block away.
Correct.
But it's not objectionable. You know, it's not like in your face.
Right. Well, I'm just saying his lights were.
Yep.
That's how they were, and no one cared to make them move them. I shut one off, and they were on all night, and they were never supposed to be on all night, because I still have the paperwork from that. Mm-hmm. And they're still on all night long.
Well, that's up to the zoning enforcement officer.
No, I'm just saying
that's supposed to enforce
lighting.
Yep.
Well, we've spent years on lighting bylaws and trying to make sure that the citizens are protected from, you know, light pollution and spillage.
A question, though, on lights that are on. Do you think, as a rule, you'll be operating as late as 11, or is that unusual? Or
that would be unusual, but it could happen. There could be a swim meet, there could be a tennis tournament, there could be a lot of things. And then, you know, cleaning up afterwards and employees leaving.
Right.
So typically, most of the public would be out of there at a reasonable hour.
I just wondered where, you know, I wasn't aware that there was a residence across the street or in the near vicinity, and I know that, I believe on the Price Chopper parking lot, we put in a requirement that their lights, they're not all on, you know, all on at the same time, because they do have late night hours that after a certain hour, they turn off some of the outer parking lot lights and light only a number of parking spaces that are closer to the building. They have that ability to turn off some of the pole lights, but not the others. So I didn't know whether it might be reasonable to...
Where his lots are relative to the parking lot?
These ones along the street.
You may be able to... Which lots are yours on here? Just to confirm again.
Because there's a whole stretch right along the road.
I have three lots.
Right. I believe I'm in here and here.
Okay.
These three, I think. Okay. 1, 2, 3. Right up to Tommy McIntyre's place.
Okay, so he's your neighbor right to the south.
Yeah, he owned right up to 15 okay. feet right. of my property.
Yeah, so you're a little ways to the north down Lumber, and I think we're the one where the house is now. It's the closest one to West Main. Is that correct?
No. No, there's... You guys have that, the first house.
He abuts 8 Lumber Street, his house.
Got it.
So he's, I mean, there's two lots, the three lots he's talking about. But his house is literally abuts 8 Lumber Street, and the lots go all the way to McIntyre's property.
Right.
But, again, his house is very close to 8 Lumber Street.
So it's more of a thing with the next one that comes through.
If there's two, again, if there's, again, if you have a building right. thing, sure. all the way down the street. But for right now, he's literally
yep.
abuts
okay.
A point of clarification?
Yep.
The dog trainer house?
Yep.
So you currently don't see, say, the Sportsman's Club lights?
No, I don't see them at all. No.
You don't see the Lumber Street Auto?
The only reason I don't see Lumber Street Auto anymore is because Tommy McIntyre built his building. You know, and it blocked all the lights, his building. Not because the lights have changed or anyone lowered the lights. His building happens to block the lights.
Okay.
That's the only reason.
Excuse me. Sure.
Let's get back to you here.
Thank you.
Okay. So,
question with Lance.
Go ahead.
Thank you. Bob, where we left off last time was the 15-foot poles were just for near the middle section of the...
Frankie, I think you're correct. That's where we left off, but we have a new proposal with LED lights at a different height.
Yeah,
we
went through any number of iterations, and then based on the last really understanding the goal where the light levels were, really, if you had to pick a hierarchy, was it the height or the levels? The levels were really what I think the intent of the bylaw was. We tried, all right, let's try to get the levels at the optimal level. And if we had to deviate from the height a little bit because of the circumstance that we have, it certainly is a unique circumstance that isn't common in other projects.
I'd like to say...
Is this going to be open 7 days a week, this place, till 11 o'clock every night?
I would
assume it would be
7 days a week for
yeah.
sure.
Yeah. Yep.
But, I mean, those would be the hours till 11 o'clock at night,
well,
every night?
Not every night, no, but...
We want the ability to stay open.
You have to have
Hopkinton doesn't have a limit of hours ordinance or anything like that. I will note that we received from the Design Review Board an endorsement of the lighting because the levels had dropped so much primarily, I think.
Well, to Mr. Evans' concern, though, maybe when there's a tournament and there's a large number of cars and you need that full lot, that's one thing. But if you're going to be open till 11 for just regular client use, I would have to assume that the number of people at the late hours is going to be smaller. Again, would it be feasible to drop down the light levels of this stretch of
the ones by the street.
The ones that are right along the street, and only keep the ones closer to the building lit so that he doesn't get as much light. I do know even when light doesn't spill off the parking lot, if the light is lit, if the lot is lit, it bounces up, and you look out and you see a brightly lit lot. Could you do like Price Chopper and turn off or lower the ones closest to the street near the neighbor?
I don't think that would work, and I can explain why. For Price Chopper, for instance, it's you usually have a much bigger lot, and you have the spaces next to the site, and then you have the ones further away, and then you typically will have customers who are in there for 15 minutes to 40 minutes, depending on how big of a shopping spree you may go on. So you do have that ability in those larger lots to do that. For a situation like this, the lot isn't broken up in like a square rectangle. You have the ones next to the building and then come down. It's a little irregular, but to Donnie's point, sometimes you may have something. We have a tournament, for instance, and it's
right.
Not that that's a 15 minute. So it's going to be for a much longer period of time, so it's kind of hard to
figure
out.
Well, I'm understanding if you have a tournament, you're probably going to have a lot of people. But if you're going to be open for regular business, regular tennis players every day till 11 o'clock, you're not going to have a really packed lot at 11 o'clock if it's not a tournament. I would think there'd be fewer cars, and so maybe under those circumstances, you could turn out the poles that are closest to closer to the road.
The problem with that would be to inform members that have contract or something, don't ever park out back there after 4:30 when it gets dark in the wintertime. You need to park closer to the building. And I just think that would, from a pure business standpoint, trying to sell that particular idea.
Well, not after 4:30. If you come in at 10 o'clock at night, the parking lot, you know, you park where the lot is lit.
Yeah, but what if somebody comes in at 7?
It's difficult to do that on this particular situation. And I agree, you know, I've done it dozens of times on larger lots like that. When you have a supermarket or a bigger retail establishment, you can actually do that for this scenario with the shape of the lot and the way we're trying to throw the light to the area where the septic system is. And if you get rid of half the lights that throw the light that way,
but the maximum was like 2 or 3 foot
candles. It's only
2.3. So we're not talking like an awful lot of light here.
Yeah, that is zero over the line.
It's and then are the lights going to be on all night long?
No.
Or 11 o'clock it goes black?
No. 1 hour after they close. 1 hour after they close.
Right. And is it true, will it go all dark? Will there be a 1 or 2 safety lights on for after hours?
And usually use the building lights this section.
On
the parking lot.
You know, because on the auto, it's right in front still, just as big, and they keep their sign lit all the time.
Okay.
Okay,
so let's see if we can get a consensus on the board. Are members happy with the current lighting plan?
The one that was approved and recommended by...
By the design review board, which has got 18-foot poles.
I have a question about this plan. Okay. I don't see where it shows any lighting on the building.
There would be, like, we're not using the building for lights. There'd be, like, an emergency light over a door or something like that. Again, the door's up over here.
Yep.
So there's no... We're not using the light to light the parking lot or anything along those lines. And again, the building's back a couple hundred feet. So there will be absolutely zero light on the building that would shine out. Certainly nowhere near the road, but it would just be by like a door or something like that.
No, but two minutes ago we talked about it, you know, when the lights are out, there'll be lighting on the building. There's no lighting on the building shown on this plan.
Yeah. There would likely be a light over the door, like an emergency exit or something like that. The intent isn't that the building's not going to be splashed and lit up all night.
I wouldn't expect it to be.
Yeah.
By buildings, they have to have.
You know, looks like they'll apply for space architects. Every exit door is required by code to have a permanent and an emergency exit light, so they would all have. And what we've been using lately is about a 25-watt LED fixture to just over the doorway. And then the porch itself that leads to the building, that would have recessed lighting that shines only on the porch, and that would only be there during business hours. But the emergency lights would have to stay, would have to be available for, would have to be available the entire time.
Right, my last question on lighting. Does the lights and the bubbles go off when you're not using the bubbles?
Yes.
Okay. Because, I mean... We have a problem with the with the bank window showing out all sorts of interior lights and glows the whole parking lot.
Oh, they're pretty. Don't put that in there.
I have a question, just for clarity, or if there's nearest resident. At the end of the day, this is all approved, this is all built. You guys can have a relationship. If there is an issue, you guys could talk and you can exchange your numbers and say, hey, listen, this light here is less visible light, or this one, or it seems to be an issue, or maybe you could work out something like that if there is an issue.
Of course. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Let's try to wrap some more things up. So sighting, I'm seeing consensus on site lighting,
yeah.
Building and design and landscaping. I think we had a clean review report from the design review board.
Mm-hmm.
I think everyone was kind of happy with the design last time we looked at it.
I thought that letter from Mr. Daugherty is very well written and clear, and I wish we had a letter like that from ConCom and every other committee that we deal with. And things like that, because I thought it was very well written and explained exactly what they decided and thought about.
Okay, so let's see. The other point of correspondence since then, we've got something on John Westerling about utilities and disturbing the road. We have a potential condition for this. I'm trying to remember if we had anything left in the detailed discussion other than what we're talking. We have Beta. We have a clean report from Beta at this point. So, Sure.
I've heard a lot about the lighting tonight, but something that I think is much more important than that is the noise issue from one of your neighbors, and I haven't really heard anything about that.
The noise from the neighbors, as opposed to mean the gun club?
It was the gun club.
We started it off, we read their letter from the lawyer into the hearing, and we were going to put a condition like we did on the other property that basically says that they acknowledge that the gun club is there and it's got the right to stay there. If that's a concern.
So are we going to be, is the gun club going to be...
harassed? No.
Coming for concessions from the owner, the developer?
No.
I'm a gun owner, so it's not a problem.
Are you the owner of the property?
Yes, I am.
Potential owner?
Yeah.
Why don't you come down there on Sunday morning and park your car there and listen for a little while?
I own the club that in Westboro that had the gun range right down, and it's just not a problem. So.
I think you'd be surprised that potential members of your tennis club would not be happy on Sunday morning listening to gun ranges in close proximity to where they're trying to play tennis.
That's his issue.
That's my issue.
Yeah, but I really don't want it to be an issue later on.
No, it can't be. Can't be. Okay. Other questions? I think we're through all the detailed discussion area.
Sidewalk.
I believe we had a proposal. Why don't you, John, go through the sidewalk issue?
So I think we were discussed. We had a meeting out out in the field. We reviewed the proposed sidewalk, to which we would be extending down the street to. It was up down to lot 4. I think it was when we presented this the last time we were in front of the board. We haven't changed anything from that submittal, but we acknowledge that there will be a sidewalk extended down the street.
Well, I'm confused. I have a plan here that shows not only down to lot 4, but the crossover that we talked about, the 400 feet of crossover, so that we do have sidewalk that goes all the way to tennis club.
I'm not sure I understand.
Something you submitted at the last hearing.
It's in the packet.
Yeah.
Who drew this? It's got the red.
It came from the applicant.
It came from the applicant.
Yes. Yeah. No, we're extending.
Yes. So it's not just to lot 4. You're doing it to lot 4, and then you're crossing over, and you're doing it on the opposite side of the street. I think you said it's like 400
feet. Yeah, from our site.
Right.
Down.
Yeah. Right. So the connectivity between the Muse and the tennis club is going
to
happen.
All the way to Muse.
Okay. So, at this point, we'll have a discussion on the site planners and whether the site plan standards have met and plan if there's any plan revisions. I believe in Elaine's memo, site plan standards start on page 6. Am I getting that right? What?
At the very end of the memo.
Oh, they're at the very end. Last couple pages. Site plan standards are there as an attachment. A through R. I think we've hit just about every one of those standards, Elaine, in our discussion.
I think you have.
Okay.
And you're going to, as part of this, the lighting plan is the special permit reference.
Correct. Okay. Are there any public comment on standards and plan revisions? Okay. Let's talk about conditions of approval.
Mr. Chairman?
Yep.
I'm not sure the order of things, so if you could advise. I would like to move that the Western Lane, Director of Public Works, four conditions be amended as part of our...
They're already in the proposed thing. Start looking at page 7.
Page 7. Thank you.
Okay. The conditions we're talking about, and you're following along?
Yes.
Do you have any, as the applicant, have any problem with what we've got on conditions of standard? Let me go through. The first one requires additional utilities in lines servicing the site are in underground. It's a waiver on the sidewalk. And we'll talk about that in condition 4, I guess. Lumber Street resurfaced by the town, and it gives conditions for John's stuff to put in there. Number 4, the sidewalk construction requirement. Number
now, I think I wrote this so that it ends a lot short of the news, so we'll change that to go to the news driveway.
Okay.
The sidewalk along lot 4 would be developed when lot 4.
That's what I put, but what the board recently discussed just a few minutes ago was that it would go to the news driveway.
We are.
Yes.
I'm sorry. Okay.
Including lot 4. Okay. Number 5 is the, in case we get some snow, too much snow. Pole number 6, the lights will be turned off 60 minutes after business is closed. Illumination should be turned off. All pylon signs. Mechanical equipment will be screened. Number 8. Number 9, dumpsters will not be emptied between 8 and 5, or before 8 and after 5. Number 10 talks about inspections if needed and who pays for them. And the applicant will also do construction debris, which is pretty standard for us, or mitigation. And number 12 is getting rid of the debris. Number 13 is a performance bond in case we have to clean something up along Lumber Street. So those are the conditions that are proposed, correct? I don't think we have any additional ones from our discussions tonight.
Is there a call to put anywhere in this finding some kind of a statement that just says something to the effect that the applicant understands and accepts the project's proximity to an existing active gun range?
We will put that in the proceedings.
Okay.
Of that. We'll make sure we have that in there.
What, in writing?
Yep. Yes. Yep.
And it has a right to be there.
Yep. Okay, so basically we have to have two votes. One is that the application, well, first of all, let's vote on the master plans, or not the master, the special permit for the lighting. And Elaine, where is that vote?
It's just a two-thirds vote. There's no conditions with that. We're just approving.
Okay, so basically, let's approve the special permit first, then we can find that everything else finds. So I'd entertain a motion to approve the special permit for the lighting, which increases the height of the poles, and it's per the plan submitted.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none. What?
If you go back to page 5.
Page 5, yes.
Just some, those would be the criteria. So by the vote, you're finding these and granting special permit.
Okay, we are also finding in this vote that we meet the criteria, which is exterior lighting will be consistent with the purposes of the bylaw, appropriate for the size and use of the property in the neighborhood setting, and all appropriate criteria set forth in the bylaw have been satisfied, and to grant it in harmony with the general purpose and intent of the bylaw. So basically, that is our findings with this vote, and then we are voting to grant the special permit for the sign. Any more comments, questions about the sign, lighting? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Okay, so now we're on page 7. Which is to find that the application conforms with the site plan standards, which is A through whatever it is, R. and that the master plan special permit, with the master plan special permit, that the board specifically permits the location of stormwater components within the building setback areas as shown on the plan. So that's the first vote. So I'd entertain a motion for that vote, which is listed on page 7, item 1.
Oh. So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Okay, we're voting now to that the application conforms with the standards. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Okay, the second one is a positive finding to vote to approve the site plan. All those in favor of approval of the site plan as submitted for the latest submittals, say aye.
Aye.
With the conditions.
With the conditions 1 through 13 is spelled out on the page. So, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. We did get, we had people that moved it. We did not? We did not have a second on that one? I thought I heard one.
So
moved?
Second.
Okay. Shall we vote again?
Yes.
All those in favor of approving the site plan with conditions 1 through 13, say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. I'd like to entertain a motion to close the public hearing.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. How do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Well, you made it. We love grand openings. We'd be happy to come and cut ribbons.
Okay.
And, good luck.
Thank you.
Thank you all.
And
thank you.
If
you're invited.
For my birthday, I got a tennis racket, so I'll be all set. To go with my tennis elbow. Okay, now we're running a little late, but we're making progress.
I did it. I'll shoot him.
Okay, let's.
You watched the video.
I did.
Actually, could use a break.
John did. Break.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
John is kind of taking a little break.
Have a good night.
Let me And I know John got his section of the master plan done, so we can talk about it without him there, because he's not guilty. Some of you guys still have sections to work on, I think, because we have not had stuff to go. I think, Claire, you're done.
John and I did it. Mm-hmm. We were one of the first ones.
I've got to go. I'm out there. I've met a couple times, but I'm happy to kind of do it maybe at the January meeting.
Okay. Okay. Well, we want to try to finish this up this term, so... And so if anyone needs help on the sections, I'd be more than happy to help.
And as you complete them, I'm taking them and putting it into a final draft document. So right now there's a couple of sections in there, but there's some blanks.
Okay. Did you take Claire's and kind of word it correctly? Because she gave you a rough idea.
Yeah, I think the board discussed it, and so yep. I put something in there. So you'll review it again when they're yep. all together.
Okay. So, trying to keep things kind of moving a little bit without, the next one is the vote to accept the resignation of ZAC committee member Sarah, how do you pronounce her last name?
Good one.
Entertain a motion to accept her resignation with thanks.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor accepting the resignation, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Anyone opposed? Anyone sure. abstain? Motion carry.
Do we know why she resigned? Or?
She was having a difficulty, I think.
Attendance? No.
No, getting along with the committee.
Oh.
There was a little bit of friction. A little bit of
difference of opinions that she could not overcome.
A little bit of drama, I guess, during some of the meetings. We're going to give John a minute or two here. Elaine, you had a special permit voting and motion guide, which wasn't in the printed packet.
Was it?
Yeah, no.
It was.
I didn't get it.
Okay.
Oh, well, then give it to me then. Okay. Elaine, do you want to talk about that for a few minutes?
Sure. I'm always trying to think of ways to have handy tools for people to use in case somebody breaks the leg and can't come to a meeting or something like that. So, or a way to look up all the different voting criteria that you have. Bylaws. So I tried to put it all in one place when it comes to special permits, because there are some that have particular criteria to look at. So that's what this is. I did something similar for the Board of Appeals as well. So, for instance, at the top of the at the top of the document, all special permits have those two criteria, and then some in the bylaw have special criteria. So when a particular issue comes up, for instance, a garden apartment, you'd be able to say what we need to vote is the first block and then go to that section and find out what the criteria is for that particular thing. So just thought it would be a handy tool for new members or old members or anyone.
You're going to put that up on the website?
Okay, yeah.
And so that way it'll make it so people can refer to it easily at a meeting. Okay, thank you. Let's see. We've got five more minutes here, so we're doing good. Approving the minutes of November 16th. Does anyone have any comments, questions? And then if not, I'll accept a motion to approve.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Do I see any further discussion on November 16th? Approval minutes?
I have one clarification. It's just the one line. And maybe I said it wrong, or maybe I'm remembering differently, but in section one about talking about the library, where I stated that I just read the document. Okay, About four or five lines down, Mr. Burchell stated, appears the agreement is out of the planning board's jurisdiction. While it's great to have access to additional parking, he has concerns regarding the effect of the town's budget. I thought I said it is not out of our jurisdiction, is my opinion, but maybe I was misremembering that.
What page are we looking at?
Page one. Section page one, one, about six lines down.
Well, whatever makes sense. We can change it.
I think that's what you said, but whatever.
Well, it changes the meaning of what you're saying. You thought it was or was not. So.
It's not complete opposite.
Complete opposite. Okay. Yeah. So if you were saying it wasn't, then.
State that appears to me is.
Not.
Is within the jurisdiction?
I believe that's what I said was that I thought.
Okay.
No, I still don't see it. I'm a little bit behind you.
The line?
Yeah. Okay. But don't you want to change it to where you'd like it to say?
How about if we change the words to say.
Eighth line down.
Within the planning board's jurisdiction.
Well, I remember thinking of saying it is not out of the planning board's jurisdiction.
Okay. Just put
just
all
one word not.
Maybe we change it into two word lines within the planning board jurisdiction, period, and then just say, while it is great to have additional parking, it's concerned with the impact on the town's budget. That might make it sound a little clearer. Probably here's the words. Look for a motion to approve the 16th of November with the one change.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Look for a motion to approve. All right. Are there any comments to the minutes of December 7th, 2015? Seeing none, I look for a motion to approve the minutes of December 7th, 2015.
So moved.
Moved.
Second.
And seconded. Not seeing any further discussion. How do you vote? Aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain?
I abstain.
One abstention. Motion, the minutes are approved. Let's see, correspondence. I don't know whether we had any.
It's just that one from the Metro West Partnership, 25 Metro West Partnership, looking for members.
And the deadline was at noon today. So
I'm sure they'll still take
them. Okay. While we're still going, we still have a couple of minutes here. I'd advise members of the board to look at the outline that was at your place tonight. There's an outline for the potential hearing for Legacy Farms Road North. Elaine put a part of it to it. I added a general discussion area. We're not going to talk about it tonight, but I would ask board members to go look through Legacy Road South, see what you like, what you didn't like, what could be better, what wasn't so bad. Maybe take a drive up Legacy Farms Road North. I know the last time, second to last time I was up there, I saw Claire walking her dog. But the road is paved almost to where the bridge is on the north side. You got to scoot around the construction barrier there at Franklin Road, but you can do that without getting too muddy. And I would recommend, if you don't have four-wheel drive, turn around at the pavement, because it's, depending on how wet it is, you might not want to go. There's gravel for a while, and then at the bridge it gets to be a little soppy, but you can kind of start doing that. We're probably thinking about maybe scheduling a site walk, maybe in early January. If we still keep these 60 days, you know, weather in January or 50 days, maybe we'll have to walk it sooner than not. But maybe we'll call that and, you know, see if somebody wants to go out in early January if we're continuing to get this unbelievable weather. But and then be prepared to really talk about the opportunity to add to the outline. You can give Elaine comments. You know, this draft was really just for you. If you think that there's other issues, you know, a lot of these issues I tried to make it as, I think, lessons that this board has learned over the last few years of dealing with the South Side.
Yeah, it looks good, Kim.
So we're, yeah, I mean, it's a start, but you know, it and I think I tried to break it into a general discussion, so then they could filter general discussions and upgrade other stuff mm-hmm. from there on. So anyway, that's where we're at for that. Does any other board member have any liaison reports or anything else they want to talk about? If not, I think it's time for our 9 o'clock hearing. And so let me call this. This is a continued public hearing, site plan review application, 34 to 40 Hayden Rowe. RPI Hopkinton LLC, this is proposed parking lot modifications and stormwater management. And come on up. So it's been a while.
Introduce Matt, sure. I'm Andrea McCarthy from Jerry Efren's office. Jerry's not here this evening, so I'm here on his behalf.
Okay. Let's see. I think there's been no new material submitted since the last time around. We had an email from Sharon, is it Listow? I always pronounce her last name wrong. Who owns the property right to the north on Church Street, expressing satisfaction with the screening. We had some revised site plans that talked about the access aisle, I believe, and I don't think we've talked about those yet.
I don't think we had time last time for you to.
So we'll want to talk about those, the latest landscaping plan, and we have had a letter from the design review board. So I think those are the three outstanding issues that we were on there. We had already received a clear bill of health from the Beta group, I believe, on stormwater and everything else. So I think we're down to those three or so issues.
And anything with respect to the DRB has been included in the updated site plan, except for the sidewalk.
Okay. So why don't you start through the site plan?
Sure. The genesis for the change was some feedback from Chief Clark about access around the site. Originally, the discussion was, can we make it to the building with any of the emergency vehicles? And when we talked to Chief Clark, he expressed a desire to be able to make a run completely circuitous around the parking lot, not get stuck in here, back in, back out, those sorts of things. So what we did to achieve that was open up the throat of that last turn here in the southwest corner. We widened that by 9 feet from 16 to 25. That island was pulled forward northerly, and those spaces that were affected were added to this location, the parking lot up in here. Once this stormwater disappeared, it made it very easy, excuse me, to introduce those three spots right in here. So now the chief has the ability to make a run throughout the parking lot with the SU-30 design vehicle. So I think we've met all his concerns.
I have a question.
Go ahead.
If you
I understand the chief's concerns. You could do that change, but don't add the spaces. Will you have enough spaces, or do you have to move the spaces?
We have to move the spaces. We're at the number, the minimum number of spaces for this use at the project with 96. So those three spaces have to be relocated somewhere on site.
Mr. Chair, quick question. So by moving the spaces over to the northerly side there, have you increased your screening for the headlights onto the neighbor's property?
I can address that when I talk about the landscape plan, or I could do it right now.
Well, let's make sure we close. Are we happy with the layout of the parking lot?
I am not. And okay. One of my reasons is that the Hayden Rowe is a major showplace street, and we're adding more spaces to the front of the building, or at least the front side, and it seems like a last-minute change, and I don't like that kind of change. I understand it's a safety concern, and maybe there's another way of looking at this. Maybe there's a back entrance or exit that could be looked at, or other alternatives. I'm not happy at all with the way this is, and I'm wondering if there could be alternatives presented.
I guess the issue we've had on this side is respect for the concerns that the neighbors voiced 12, 15 years ago about access onto Church Street. We specifically closed up those openings. Fred Grant constructed the parking lot that you see now out of respect for the concerns of the Church Street people. So as we move forward with this, how do we balance that history to achieve that? And I think at the last hearing, which was probably November now, the residents of Church Street we're very concerned about changes to that existing landscaping that was there. I think one of the neighbors expressed a concern that we not introduce any breaks in Church Street because that landscaping was functioning so well. So if we're maintaining our single access to here and we need to respect the use of the playground, the stormwater at the neighbors, I'm not sure where else I take those response.
Exactly. So my point is, through the chair, and respectfully to the process in your work, you're a neighbor as well as a professional. I appreciate it. But maybe the building could, maybe the building could use a couple less units inside of it so that we need less parking on it. Because I don't want to see this become a big parking lot. Even if we're creeping forward towards that, and if the safety concern that the chief's concerned about, great, we'll do that, but let's not add additional parking to the front or side of the building. And if it means having less units, that's what it means.
But let me see if I understand it. We've reduced that frontage from what it exists now, didn't we? We've grassed over a whole area of that.
The curb cut itself is probably shrunk in half. So the additional screening here, the reduction in pavement,
is there a reduction of pavement in that area where he's pointing?
Do you want to talk about the previous approval that had parking spaces here?
We had a 57-foot wide opening there now that is being reduced to the 24, so cut in half, if you will. The landscaping that has been introduced in that area where the pavement is going away, I think adds something tangible to this design, to the project. And the fact that we had 105 spaces in these same locations, I think the reduction to 96, again, is a benefit to the neighborhood. I think the work that Mike has done with the landscape design, I think will help balance some of those concerns that you have.
Right? Maybe we talk about the landscaping, and then we'll come back to both of them together. Okay, why don't we talk?
I hope everybody can sort of see this. The changes that we've made since last time, first of all, I'll talk about the issue of the change in the parking first. Because we were able to get rid of the stormwater treatment over here, we're able to retain, first of all, there's a very large group of yews there that are 8 or 10 feet high, which completely screen from here to here. And these are, by the way, these are accurate measurements of the sizes of these trees and shrubs as well. So we have some, a huge Norway maple here. We have a large blue spruce here, which really screens it not only from Hayden Row, but from the northeast corner of the site as well. We've added arborvitae along here where there is a gap in the screening. We've added a line of arborvitae here and here so that the headlights won't shine off the site. And the to the neighbor on the northwest corner, we've asked, added a mixed row of mixed shrubs, most of which are evergreen. And the abutter over here is satisfied with the
with the rail fence.
Oh yeah, and the yeah, we tied the discussion of this of the trying to discourage people from cutting through here and sort of containing them on the site. So we've added a split rail, 36 inch high post and rail fence here and along here up to this point.
We asked her specifically if she wanted a solid fence or a open one, and because it's so close to her driveway, she preferred to not have a solid fence.
Okay.
And so instead we did the post and rail fence with a mixed landscape screening.
Okay. How tall are the arborvitae along the northern area there that you just talked about?
We're going to plant them at 4 to 5 foot height.
And they grow about how much per year?
They'll grow anywhere from 8 to 12 inches a year. This is a particularly fast-growing arborvitae, which is called Green Giant, and they'll get at least 20 feet high.
And so, do they grow how fast per year?
Seven to 8 to 12 inches per year.
4 foot is, I don't know, it's low. It's not a lot of screening.
In my experience, when you plant bigger trees, they're a little more fragile. We like to, this is a sort of a comfortable height. We don't want to go lower than that because it doesn't have any effect.
Sure, I wouldn't go lower. But
and if we go, you know, we can go, when we go higher, you have to spread them out a little more so you don't get the effect as much. They don't want to be so close together. So with the spacing that we have, which is 5 feet on center, a 4 to 5 foot height is about the right height for that type of spacing.
Comment from the
This is Wright.
Claire Wright, 28 Hayden Row Street. I want to point out to the board that along that northern property line, there are no parking spaces there right now. The new plan introduces, I'm not sure, I've seen various plans that went anywhere from 16 to 21 spaces. I'm not sure how many spaces are on your current plan. How many are there? Is it 21 now? Right now, what we look at is the driveway. And then we look at the parking lot and the parking distance. So a big chunk of the lawn is going to turn into parking directly facing us. And I have some photographs that the board can look at that show the grassy strip between our property, much of which will become car bumpers beyond these views. There's also a view out of bedroom window where you can see not only directly a direct view of the windows of the what will now be condominiums, but you can see the grass strip and the roadway, which now is going to be car bumpers, a whole, that entire strip of parking that is being shown there doesn't exist. We have one right now. So we're going to have 20-some cars right off the edge of the property. And on the northern, on the opposite side, our neighbor, Mr. Callery, when Fred Grant redeveloped the property, he put in a solid row of arborvitae and a fence to provide total blockage so that he had privacy and maintained a pleasant yard. This is what is on the opposite side. We would like that type of screening because we are going to be going out into our garden and have 20 car bumpers. and a 96-car parking lot right off the edge of our property. It's a drastic change and a drastic intrusion in our privacy and our quality of life and the resale of our property to have 21 car, stripped cars right up against us. Just notice those do not exist. They're saying there are fewer cars, 96 versus 105, but they're up against our yard now.
Questions? Are these the same variety of giant variety along the South Row, or
they're
close?
They're close, yeah.
We like the fence as well, so that as those come in, we have a screen to the headlights and to people getting in and out of their cars only a couple feet away from us in our yard. And the lights, the reflection from the parking lot that we see, we look out and see the glow of the parking lot. It doesn't spill onto the yard, but you see a 96-car lit parking lot. It's a tremendous impact.
What do you think about a fence in that location, a solid fence, as opposed to
instead of arborvitae?
Both, no, like Mr. Kelly instead. Has.
Like this photo here?
Correct.
Bottom.
So that's basically the arborvitae are on the...
The topography on this side of the site, I mean, I'm going to have to look to both Joe and Michael, but the topography is that it pitches down. And so a fence isn't, I don't believe it's going to do much with the headlights because of where the top of the fence would be.
Okay.
What's the topography there?
It's a boundary line, 494-4, we're going up to 499. Pump of the car would be at 452, headlights would be at 452.
So what does that mean?
What do you think?
So you're saying the headlights, bumper to headlights 452 and it goes down to
what? Well, down to 494 at the boundary line. That's when he put fence.
The U is up higher. That's definitely blocking these ones. The two of us went out there and stood there and tried to figure out what would be the best shielding mechanism, and this is what we came up with.
Does a 4-foot arborvitae do?
No, it's dropping off to the Wright's property is what we're saying.
Correct, yes. Right. This is higher than this.
And by how much?
Right now it runs from
4 feet.
497.5 down to 494.
So dropping 3 feet.
3 feet, and we're lifting that parking lot slightly.
So 4-foot arborvitae planted where?
There's nothing.
Does nothing. It's.
So, how long of a run do you want a fence?
I want to be completely shielded from this project. I want my yard to look like Mr. Calvary's yard. I don't want to see it. I don't want to see these lights. I don't want to see these cars. I know the target body will take time, but I want a complete block.
So, from the Norway spruce to the Lisnow property?
Yes.
How long does this run?
Call it 100 feet.
And even though the U is there, you want arborvitae in front of that?
We don't care about the U. We don't want to see your parking lot.
If I may, part of the charm of Hayden Rowe are the historical buildings. The building that you have is part of the rural industrial revolution, and many of the homes in the area were built by managers of the company that were there. And at the time, they valued trees and space and grandness that exists on Hayden Row. We want to keep that. So I think that if I'm looking at it now, the southern side has the arborvitae that were from the original revamp, well, one of the revamps from, I think, the 80s, and they've grown quite nicely, and there is a 6 foot, if not taller, fence there, and I believe it would be in character to do the same thing on the north side, because the arborvitae will grow, and they mature at 20 feet, and they don't grow any higher. They grow fuller, but not that much.
If that's what will make you guys happy, then we'll put a fence from the beginning of the Norway spruce to the end of the property line. We'll put arborvitae on our side of that fence, and you'll be shielded.
No, the fence needs to be on your side, and the green needs to be on our side.
So you want us to plant?
I want to look at a fence. I want to look at greenery, but I want the fence to completely block your headlights.
So the fence on the property line and the trees on your property?
Like calories. Just the fence is on the industrial side, and the shrubs are on the residential side.
Okay.
What type of fence are we talking about?
Can you hold on? We do the same one as this. That's what she's asking for.
The stockade fence.
Yeah. Stockade. Okay. I just wanted to clarify.
It's a 6 foot stockade.
Yes. Yeah. Do you know where the garden ends? Because I believe the garden is right up against the property line. In order to plant those, some of the garden may have to be removed. Yeah. Would that be?
I think they're talking about putting the fence right here.
No, the way that this is that the fence is on the property line and the plants are planted on the Calories property. We would do the same thing here. We put the fence on the property line as to not give them additional property, and we would plant on their behalf, on their property, a row of arborvitae on the side.
Where were the fruit trees that were coming out?
Those are on our property.
They were there, right. They're over on the
when we walk out, I'm pretty sure that mm-hmm. your garden goes right up to the property mm-hmm. line. So if we put the fence there, and then we plant these on your side, we're going to have to remove some of your garden in order to plant those.
Why don't you just put the trees right on the very edge? Is that on the edge of the garden still?
If we put the fence anywhere other than on the property line, we will basically be giving you that property.
No, you'd be putting the trees on the property line.
But then where would we put the fence?
The trees and the fence should both be on your land.
If we put the fence on this side mm-hmm. of the trees, mm-hmm. we would in effect be giving you that property.
Well, it's listed in the plot plan as to where the land is.
Over time, you could make the claim that since you've been using that area, that it's now your property.
Through you, Mr. Chairman, pardon mm-hmm. me, but if you did these trees that you were proposing here,
yeah.
how is that any different? Why can't you still put those trees and put a fence on the other side? You're just talking about a fence.
Because now I'm putting a fence now I'm going to have to put a fence 4 feet onto our property. I'll put the fence on the property line, as the Calories have done, and then we will plant on your behalf, on your property, in regular spacing.
I know what you're proposing. I'm just saying what you've got right there. If we were going with what you propose right now, you have those trees planted on the property line. Do you not?
Without a fence.
Without a fence.
And
so I'm asking you to continue to plant the trees on the property line.
If you want,
and move the fence in.
If you want a fence, we will put a fence up on the property line. We will not put a fence on our side of the property line, 3 or 4 feet, to then give you the additional benefit of our property.
I don't understand how that's any different than doing what you're doing right there, except putting the fence on the other side of the shrubs for additional screening.
Can you explain this, Jeff?
If I could just, yeah. I think the point of the fence is a shield from the lights of the parking. It's not a boundary marker. The trees on the south side, I think I don't know, but you're probably correct. The fence is on your
well,
property.
Well, but
the site plan shows the right existing fence.
Right, exactly.
On the south side, the guy that did subdivided the lot on the south side owned both properties when he put the fence and the trees in. So it was one owner at that time.
But
My concern is facing of Hayden Rowe, what it's going to look like if it's in character and remains in character with Hayden Rowe. And in my view, the fence and the arborvitae are to shield the neighbors to the north and also on Church Street from the extra parking lot activities. And also, that's all I have to say about that, just part of it right now.
I guess the issue that we see on this side of the table is we have a compact site and a few things that are out of our control. The placement of the building, the shape and size of the building. These areas here to the north and to the northwest, the only spots that we have available to provide amenities to the folks that are going to use this building, whether this proposal moves forward or not, this is an opportunity for Brett to give some amenities to these unit owners. That area is valuable. There's just not a lot of it there. So to give up 5 or 10 to the planting screening combination is something that creates a bit of a burden for us.
We're offering to pay for the screening that the Wrights are looking for. They're asking for land as well, and we're not willing to give them land.
Excuse me, I'm not asking for land. I'm asking you to put your trees where you've got them on that plan and simply back them up with a fence just behind the trees. It doesn't run the length of the property. It just provides additional screening from the headlights on that stretch of trees. Nothing changes.
I will lose the benefit, or our project will lose the benefit of the land if we put the fence the appropriate distance onto our property.
I'm sorry, through you, Mr. Chair, there is still a grass stretch between there and your parking lot. Is there not, or are your cars right up to the edge of that fence?
What he's saying is it's going to be reduced by approximately 4 feet in order to do it your way.
And it's an area that we could use for other purposes that is beautification for our site.
But you still got area between where the fence would go and where your cars are. It's a grass strip. So I don't see how much you're losing by simply putting a fence up against it. You've still got a stretch of grass.
This is the offer.
But we're being really proud of you.
This is our offer. We're willing to put a fence up. We're willing to plant an entire row of arborvitae, 100 feet long. The fence needs to be on the property line. That's our offer.
Okay, let's let that one sit for a little while. Frank, we've got a screening to the north issue. Are your concerns about screening on Hayden Rowe?
Well, screening is one issue.
You do have a couple of new trees right along.
Yeah, we're planting 3 trees to help the sight line as you're driving by looking into the site, and those should help shield the vehicles.
What I'm interested in learning more about as far as what Joe mentioned was, I'm looking at here we are today, and from what Joe was saying, it sounds like the driveway is coming up to maybe around here, and then it's going to be less wide, and then comes in so many feet.
This is true.
Maybe up to the here, and now you're adding maybe 4 or 5 more spaces from one side to the other. And I wonder what that looks like in your design. We don't have a color kind of version.
Sure. What we have done is, in essence, within a couple of feet, held that northerly edge to your left, and have put in the minimum width opening for the travel ways back and forth, the 24 foot wide by planning board standards, and then have taken out the pavement subtly of that. Along the area where they do the drop off now, if you can picture that in your mind's eye.
Yes.
So some screening has been added to that, and that asphalt has been severely
decreased, and then Mike has added in the screening here as a focal point. And then all those breaks inside, if you see his plan, those islands that we have left inside the parking lot, so that that view shed is broken up by the plantings here along the edge, in the center, and points throughout the site. So I think that view from Hayden Rowe is certainly buffered with Michael's designs.
How far north is the most northerly parking space in comparison to what is currently there? Is it about the same, or is it a little bit more? Is it 4 feet more, 5 feet more, 10 feet more, or about the same? Because it could be just...
That edge of the gravel now runs through those proposed parking places along the north side.
So about 4 or 5 feet.
So these have come 4 or 5 feet this way, beyond the limits of the gravel that you see there now.
And in the current plan, with the changes for safety concerns, how deep does the from Hayden Row to the first parking space, how many feet is that?
80 feet.
So that...
85 feet.
That's about to maybe right around here. And these trees are also staying.
It's beyond the existing entryway, that appendage that sticks out into the parking lot.
It's beyond
that first space will be westerly of that.
Okay.
So dramatic distance from Hayden Rowe.
So greenery-wise, we're gaining some. You're adding trees. You're not changing any of these current trees, the two big ones and the smaller ones.
Well, the one, there's one dead tree that is coming down. it's bare now.
Okay.
So just making that clear.
And from the street, we're seeing additional green, additional trees, but further on in, it's being 4 or 5 feet more parking and about 80 feet in, that's where that starts. And before Chief Clark's comments, it was a little bit further in.
It was two spots in.
Yes.
20 feet.
Width of two spots, yep. Yeah.
Okay, where are we going here? It seems to me that the Hayden Rowe issue is pretty well set. We're just talking about the only thing left to really sort out is the northern boundary.
Will there be a fence along the front on Hayden Rowe or just to the property?
Not along Hayden Rowe, no.
Mr. Wright, your property line is it the garden fence that exists today? Is that essentially what it is?
Pretty much so, yes.
Okay. I think this picture does a nice job in terms of articulating what their property line is relative to the additional space, as well as the decline in elevation off of what I assume to be the parking lot here, and then it dips down to a certain area. So I could pass it back, and I think it really does help illuminate some things around what is being proposed and what the potential impact could be on the abutter.
And these trees here stay?
No, those if we are going to be planting a 100-foot row of arborvitae and putting a fence up those, and likely the yews would go, and then we would we'd figure out what to plant there to make it aesthetically, our side of the stockade fence to be aesthetically pleasing to our project. We hadn't contemplated putting in a fence for that run-up, and so we didn't contemplate the landscaping, but we would do probably something similar to this to make it more appealing to the people on our side of the fence.
Okay. Stuck with two dilemmas. One is, we've been found by the Board of Appeals that if we approve a site plan that doesn't have everything shown on it, or that we can condition and occur in a way that one would understand, ZBA likes us to have the final plan submitted. And yet, and the other dilemma is, obviously, there's still some point of view between your neighbors on the north and yourself of where it is. I think that's the only issue that's left for approval on this area. I personally like the fence idea, and where exactly on the northern boundary is, I think, subject to negotiation one way or the other. Or whether you put trees on both sides of the fence, or bushes or whatever, or screening to make, you know, the fence look better, and whether it's a stockade fence or whether you prefer something that looks white vinyl or something that blocks headlight. I personally don't care. But we are already almost 25 minutes beyond where I was hoping to be tonight, and we've got one other guy that's been patiently waiting that we need to take care of. I'm hoping that we could resolve it, but I don't think we can tonight. Elaine, when do we have another half an hour at our next meeting, hopefully?
That's January 11th, and so right now you have hearings. The last one, which is Pulte, starts at 8:15, so I think you would be available at 9:15.
Yes. That's the only way I think maybe to give it a little bit more time, come up with a little bit more discussion. So make it a best and final offer if that's what it is, and give us two options and put them on a plan. And if worse comes to worse, this board will play solemn.
So is the only discussion now is basically where the fence is?
We have approved plans with put the screening on the neighbor's property, and we're comfortable with that, provided the neighbor's comfortable with that. Or whether you put the fence on the line and put the trees on your side. I'd come up with a couple of options if you can't figure out with the rights as to which.
Well, there really only are two options. I mean, it's the fence and the greenery on their side.
Well, they see a fence. And maybe some greenery that gets taller over a few years, and they see it over the top of the fence.
If the greenery is on their property, which we pay for, then they don't see a fence.
That's correct.
Yeah. So, and then they
Or you put some greenery on your side, and it grows taller than the 8 feet over a few years, and they'll see a fence. They'll see what that picture is there. And it's up to you and the neighbors as far as what kind of fence. You know, if you like white vinyl, we've proved those before. If you like the stockade,
But can that be a condition that's included in?
I don't know how to put it on a plan that really spells it out, and I personally think you need both of you to think about it for just a little bit longer.
Logistically, it's not just two solutions. There's at least four or more that you can come to. It's not either or. So. Yeah.
The chair. I'm just trying to see if there's any way to play with the elevation change. And the idea is that the arborvitae is the screening and something to block the headlights until the arborvitae's filling. Is that the basic goal?
I think that was the thinking about the fence.
Okay. Would a low row of dense hedges at the edge of the parking lot do that?
In place of the arborvitae?
In place of the fence.
Possibly.
Because that might be an alternative.
Mm-hmm.
or a low road, a berm, or...
So the headlights can't go through that hedge.
Because nobody wants, eventually nobody wants the fence.
That would be the preference.
If the arborvitae's are filled in, they don't want to see the fence, and you don't want to see the fence. So maybe the alternative is come up with something from day one that is really tight, dense, and because it is, you're playing with the elevation, if it's close to the edge of the lot, you're not having to plant very high. Just a suggestion.
Yeah, no, it's a good idea. Okay.
I have a request. This is a view from Hayden Row, and I would like to kind of see what the vision is from the ground view as we go by on parades and walking up and down the street. I mean, it's a very well-traveled street, you know, people, high visibility street. And I would wonder what it would look like now with the Chief Clark's recommendations and that's all. Just a request.
Okay. So it sounds like we're down to landscape. Yes, sir.
Jim Canallery, 4 Maple Street. Just a quick question. How long do the provisions on this plan have to remain in place? And the only reason I ask is I'm at 4 Maple, so I own the property on the south side. I have the arborvitae, I have the fence. If that fence is to come down, if it falls down, disrepair, is it a requirement of the landowner to replace it?
Right.
Typically, I think that's, they have to maintain the site plan.
Is that part of the site plan?
It is, I believe.
It is shown. It's part of the previous site
plan. Previous site plan.
The one in 2001 when your lot was subdivided.
And under Mass Law, if the fence is like this and it falls down and it's on their property and they're the owner of the fence, then they'd maintain it. Is that...
But if it just comes in... The reason I ask, those arborvitae are so overgrown, and those are on my property, they're pretty bare behind that fence. So that fence comes down. It's Swiss cheese, basically, mm-hmm. right? So if that fence is to come down, I just really want it to be maintained. And I'm just wondering, if you know, is that a provision of the site plan? You know.
Yes. Yeah. I think it's shown on the plan. Yes. It's shown on the previous plan, and it carries forward.
Mm-hmm.
For a, is, yeah, is that your understanding of it? I mean, is that your...
I'm not sure.
Okay.
It's the first time the question has been asked about.
Look to continue the hearing until January 11th at 9:15.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote? Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries.
Can we just get clarification that that's the only outstanding issue?
As far as I know, it is.
I have an issue with the
well,
I trust that it'll be okay, but I would like to see it.
So, if we understand correctly, we're going to come in with two ideas out here talking about the rights.
If you two can come up with a single one, we're happy with that one, because then we don't have to play Solomon.
Okay.
If you can't, come up with one and we'll flip a coin or something. I don't know.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay. I'd like to open the continued public hearing for Eversource. This is on tree cutting on particularly Wilson Street, and we have a couple of trees left on Ash Street. And I'm hoping we will get through this in the next few minutes. Chris, come on up.
How's everybody doing?
Yeah, we're doing good. Other than the fact we're behind schedule.
That's okay. I'm a patient man.
I know you have been. Okay. What? Where is my tree cutting piece? What? Yes. Okay.
And I once again kind of consolidated it because we determined that some of the trees were actually on private property, so I omitted those from this list.
Did you get the other board members' copies out if anybody
needs them?
And it's attached to the agenda.
It's attached to the agenda, okay. So basically.
Does anybody want a copy of this?
Sure. Yeah.
I've got one more.
Okay. On Wilson Street, it was Frank Durso and myself ended up doing the walk. And basically, for those who have walked with us on the other streets, we kind of used the same criteria. You know, we were
the ones on Wilson Street were all of basically a much smaller location or size, though there was a few big pine trees, but there wasn't the massive big oaks that were on the other street that we all voted to save. So referring to the, without going through every tree, you're here for...
Just learning, is that okay?
Sure. If you had concerns about a particular tree, we'd make sure that, that takes care of.
Concerns about him for just sitting and observing?
I mean, we've gone through every tree at the last couple ones.
I was going to say, I learned quite a bit listening to that last bit of the previous hearing, so...
Yeah,
I'm wondering about the arborvitaes they were talking about. I feel like the deer are just going to eat those things to pieces.
Yeah.
That's probably why they're bare on the 6 feet.
That's
the fences.
That's exactly right. Because they know that their chins can only reach up so far.
Yep. So, anyway, we did the walk, and you can see it attached to your agenda. We added a couple of smaller trees in a couple of locations. Do board members want us to go through every tree, or do you want to just agree with the list as Frank and I put it together?
Are there any to be saved?
What?
Are there any to be saved?
There was a couple that were on private land, per my notes.
Well, when you said reduced by 43, is that because some are like dead or they're in private land, or is that
that was
some
both
are
of it?
Cut?
Yeah. If I said okay, I mean there was like we didn't find the two oak and the two sassafras on line 14, I guess it was. You know, we found some private ones are clearly on the private land. So basically, I'm not so sure there was too many of these of the little size that we were saving on the street. We kind of agreed with, you know, there are ones that were right under the wires. If they got topped, they would look like hell. And most of Wilson Street had a lot of forest as the next row. And, you know, are we losing something with it? Probably not as much. I mean, they're, you know, the trees, if they're there, they're up. There are people right behind it. I'm not so sure that most people that don't ride that road every day will miss significant amount of these trees at the end of the day.
Can you speak to the pine, the three pine that are in the 12 to 18 inch? Those are a couple of big ones. Were those all kind of unavoidable?
Yep.
Yeah, those were right at the beginning of the street near the intersection with East Main. I mean, those were the first ones that we looked at. I mean, I think we all kind of decided that there wasn't really a whole lot that we'd be able to do with those. I mean, we could certainly prune them, but, you know.
Is that on the east, are those on the east side of the street?
Yes, yes.
By the pond there?
Yeah, yes, by that pond. Yeah. They were badly topped already. They were misshaped as it was. They looked like they'd been topped maybe two or three prunings worth.
Yeah, well, yeah, I mean, these trees were all, I've got them in the 12 to 18 inch category, say that they're between 14 and 15 inches. I mean, a pine that's 14, 15 inches should be, you know, 50 feet tall, where these were, had been topped so much that they were probably about 30 feet tall, 40 feet tall, you know.
And, at the end of the, and part of that, I think with the pond, we didn't think that they were, and I think we were also a little more concerned, or at least I was, that, the pines, you know, could potentially bring the wires down with the snow more so than some of the other. And the wires on Wilson Street, from a public safety standpoint, we do want electricity continuing on Wilson Street for what, you know, what's up at the end needs. I mean, it's got backup stuff and everything else, but keeping that thing going is much, much a good thing. I'd entertain a motion to approve the cutting for the notes that we put together in the plan.
So moved.
Second.
Further discussion? Okay, seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed, anyone abstained, motion carries. And then we had two more trees on Ash Street that we had left off at the last. We were kind of, we stopped walking when Claire and I were walking. And Chris and I looked at those two. They're somewhere around.
There were two, I think there was a couple of birch trees we looked at, and there was also one big oak, which we had pretty much decided was not going anywhere.
The big oak was not going anywhere. There was two small birch right at, I don't know, 116 or whatever.
Yep, I've got them at 116 Ash Street, between poles 53 and 54, and then between 49 and 50, that's where we had the big oak tree, which we were going to decide that we're not going to be doing anything.
Right. So
there's two more birches to come down?
Two more birches.
And they were the inch and a half to sink to a six-inch category.
Small,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. So that's just, and the rest of that Ash Street list was off in the non-scenic part of Ash Street. Mm-hmm. And these birches were going right to the wires. Mm-hmm. I mean, from right below it, right, skirting right up.
Yeah.
So, and entertain a motion to take those last two birches and add them to our Ash Street list.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Any further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye. Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Chris, we voted for Wilson Ash in front. I still haven't finished. Elaine's drafted the first two already. I got to review them. There was two trees on Front Street that she was a little confused. I got to go look at my notes, or maybe some of us on the Front Street.
Do you remember off the top of your head any idea where they would be?
Well, I think the question was whether, I think there was a discussion of two oaks and whether there were two oaks to be removed or whether there were the two oaks near Cobbler's Way that were to be saved.
Yeah.
So I took them off the list rather than put something on the list that shouldn't come down, so...
Yep, I will go look at those over the next couple of days and make sure, and then...
I have both your lists, and it's really hard to compare them.
Okay. I know that there were two oaks that we had decided that were going to be pruned rather than actually
I removed. Think those...
That was across, I think, from North Mill. I don't remember actually the ones closer to Cobbler's Way.
No, I think that's where the...
Yeah.
I think it's one of those where if I get my notes back from her, I will be able to... sort those all out.
I guess one other thing that I wanted to ask you about that I forgot to bring up at the last hearing we had was I spoke to the gentleman who is the, I guess, the caretaker of the Cobbler's Way. We met the time we were out there.
Yep.
And there were some trees that were actually on private property that I was going to have one of my foresters approach him about getting permission to remove because there were some bad rot and some nasty trees that I thought were hazards coming out. But he said that he was under a restriction because of that land was under a restriction.
Probably in the open space.
Yeah, it was Brian Gassett that we met out, and it was in the open space area.
But he hasn't conveyed the open space yet, so he still owns it.
He still owns it, so he has the authority to do it at this point.
If they're diseased and near dead or dead.
Yeah, they were set back from the road, so I don't think it's anything.
But they were leaning.
Yeah, they were leaning
towards, and they've been rotted
in the sun for quite a while.
So, at this point, I don't think we have any jurisdiction of them, but go get it sorted out with him. And
well, I mean, if you want, again, you would like me to speak with him and then just kind of communicate with you guys exactly what I was able to...
Like
you should probably mention it to the land trust, too, before it happens.
Okay.
Okay.
And I guess the last thing I wanted to bring up, for the pruning itself on Wilson Street... we had you had approved pruning up to about Rafferty Road was. I was looking at our plan, our yearly operation plan, and the electrical circuit that comes in from Ashland down Howe and into down Rafferty and the rest of Wilson. We're going to be pruning that this year. So I'm assuming that I'm going to have to go through the same exact process, basically, as far as getting the list of butters, but I don't really know exactly who the butters are on. Rafferty is not a scenic road, but the rest of Wilson is, right?
Yep.
So, I mean, I guess I don't know who I would be letting know that we'd be doing the pruning. I don't know if anybody even lives out that way.
Well,
beyond Rafferty Road.
On Kruger Road that might be concerned.
Okay.
Yeah, we have one guy that came to all of our hearings on Rafferty Road, Mr. Small, and he will be very vocal.
Okay.
He's the guy that was upset about that one tree that came down, I think, when they put the pole in.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Question about procedure and the order of things. Things that are on this outline, I noticed that they were already pruning Saddle Hill.
Mm-hmm.
That's what we approved.
That's different from the cutting. We gave the pruning decision, has already been formalized. We haven't done the tree removal ones yet.
Thank you.
So.
Yeah, I think they just started last week on Saddle Hill and Fruit Street, and I haven't looked at it yet, but it was tomorrow. I was actually going to go out there and take a look at it. I've been communicating with Mr. Gleason. You know, and he said he's satisfied with what he's seeing. So, you know, as far as I know, so far things are going well, and I haven't had any complaints. So, but once again, like I said, I'm probably going to get out there tomorrow and take a look at it myself, just to make sure everything's on the up and up.
Well, we appreciate that. We enjoyed walking with you.
Yeah. Hey, like I said, I think it was good luck. You know, we've had such nice weather.
It was
we should do this every weekend.
Yeah. Okay. I think at this point, board members, we've concluded all the business. Oh, do we need to close the public hearing?
If you're done.
What?
If you're done.
I think we're done. Look for a motion to close the public hearing for the tree removals.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. So.
So like I said, I'll have to submit another application for pruning on the remainder of Wilson Street, and I think Cross Street, is that a scenic road?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so Cross, I believe, is also in our yearly operation plan. I would have to look a little bit deeper to see if there's anything else, but I'm pretty sure that those are the only two that we would have for 2016, so
and if
you guys will see me again at some point.
Yeah,
exactly. I mean, as far as the removals themselves go, like, you know, probably in the future, I'm probably just going to rely on Mr. Gleason as a tree warden for approval on anything that he thinks is a natural hazard instead of going through the process of going in front of the planning board. You know, not that I haven't enjoyed this, but.
You're more than welcome to come back.
When they're pruning, I noticed there are some trees that are actually on the wires. They'll take those away too.
Not if they're on the Verizon's wires. Only if they're on the top two.
Yeah, if they're on the cable, telephone, those lower wires, that's
they
not
don't
something
care.
That we're going to prune.
I noticed there's at least two bodies of trees that have fallen and they're touching wires near Claire Wright's house. Not Claire, Connie Wright's house.
Oh.
Hey, you had me very confused. I was like, we're not pruning right in the room.
You'll see them when you get there.
Okay. I mean, do you have just so that I'm not driving up and down the street looking for it, do you have a specific location?
We can
give it to you in a few minutes here.
Okay.
We'll talk later.
Okay. I think it's Saddle Hill. Rebellion, Shays Rebellion, or whatever.
That's why I still call it that.
They changed it?
Yeah, they changed it to something more peaceful sounding.
Daniel Shays.
Yeah, we got the Rebellion, yeah.
Anyway, okay. I think it's a Daniel Shays. And yeah, so. Okay. Look for a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
I just have a comment for the board. It doesn't have to do with Chris. Do with the trees.
Go ahead.
I just wanted to make a comment on the lighting and the tennis club thing, that we've written our bylaw to say that these things should comply with the International Engineering Society standards, and I think it actually does reference a specific book, but it appears, looking at their multiple sets of plans, that how you interpret compliance can depend on which set of ISNA standards you want to use, because I look back and the plan that they submitted in April, and then they claim that, well, you know, you asked for it to comply with ISNA standards, and this is what ISNA is telling us, and those were for ISNA for common shopping centers with medium, community shopping centers with medium activity level. They had an ISNA recommendation average 3.6 foot candles with a minimum of 0.9. The plan they came back to us with that we just approved on December 15th was a new set of ISNA standards. This was ISNA standards for illumination standards for parking lots, and their horizontal illumination minimum, according to ISNA, was 0.2. So the first set of ISNA standards that they used had a minimum of 0.9. The second set of ISNA standards that they used had a minimum of 0.2. The plan also said the lighting is in general compliance with the engine ISNA lighting standards. So,
well, we've got to maybe check a little bit careful to make sure they're applying the right type of building to the standards.
I guess
because I wouldn't have called that a parking lot.
The takeaway is that you can comply depending on which set of ISNA standards you want to hold yourself to. So if you want a highly lit parking lot, you can say, but these ISNA standards
require this. Well, no.
But there's actually another set of ISNA standards.
Book is this thick. It's full of standards. But what you got to do is apply the right one. A tennis club shouldn't have been a
community shopping center.
The activity leader reviews that and goes back to them and...
But that's what they used. Yeah. They chose to use because they wanted more light. And then when we pushed back, then they went to a lower set of standards.
Sure.
So, you know, just be for us to beware not to fall for the, this is what ISNA is requiring, because it depends on what you look at.
I think a lot of the standard has to do with uniformity of light within the parking lot, too. But, okay, I think we're ready for a motion to adjourn, or did we already have the motion?
Moved and seconded.
Moved and seconded. You're ready to vote on a motion to adjourn. Let's get out of here. All those in favor getting out of here, say aye.
Aye.
Thank you very much. Merry Christmas to everyone.
Christmas.